Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is my privilege to moderate the next panel. I would start by saying that the topics in the previous panels, as well as the quality and the intensity of the debate, was tremendous. But people were talking about deterrence, about hot conflicts, about Cold War, and everyone seemed to be very switched on, very engaged. It is our task to cover perhaps a less exciting or less dramatic topic in the panel, in a session which is immediately after lunch and which is usually called the graveyard session. Because the energy of the participants is focused primarily on digestion. So I will try then to raise the level of the energy by being slightly provocative in my opening, my initial remarks. And I will start by saying that I'm someone who is fascinated by history, and therefore by trade, and therefore by geopolitics. I think everyone knows that the center, so-called center of gravity of the world economy is traveling. Economists have determined that it started 1,000 years ago in Kazakhstan. Then it moved west with the development of the Western world, and it reached Iceland in the 80s of the 20th century. And then with the growth and the rise of the Asian economies, it traveled back and it's now close to where it started, which means that the center of gravity of the world economy is moving east. Therefore, Eurasia is very relevant economically as well. That would be my first comment. Second, I read recently that Japanese archaeologists found Roman coins in the ruins of a very old Japanese castle. And a few months ago, I read that Chinese artifacts dating from the 3rd century Anno Domini, our era, were found in Scandinavia. All these are evidence of intensive trade going back thousands of years. Now, trade was primarily by way of goods initially. And what trade required? It required an infrastructure, it required security, it required trust and rules to be implemented by a hegemon. And we all remember that, for instance, the first Silk Road emerged in the 2nd century before Christ, and then it flourished during what was called Pax Romana. And the Romans were great at building infrastructure and implementing rules. Then the Silk Road flourished, and I think it reached its zenith during the Mongol Empire, during the Pax Mongolica. And unlike the common perception, the Mongol Empire encouraged trade, was very tolerant, and rules were respected. Then the Mongol Empire collapsed, and then with it, it was the end of the Silk Road as we knew it. Then we saw other trade routes, this taking preeminence, and this time these were not land-based, but rather sea trade routes. And we have seen, for instance, rules being implemented during what was called Pax Britannica, followed by Pax Americana, which was about the freedom of movements of goods on the seas of the planet. Sometimes we take, for instance, this freedom for granted. But let's remember how difficult and challenging it is to move goods around the Horn of Africa when you have to face some Somali pirates. Or think about the thrills and the emotions and which are generated every now and then on the Strait of Hormuz, which is the place and the bottleneck where 40% of the crude oil passes. Now, in the era of globalization, some people are challenging the benefits of the globalization, of the openness of the societies. I want to refer you again to one example in history. In the 15th century, China was by far the most advanced country in the world. And they were the dominant power by far. And based on an internal decision, they closed onto themselves. 400 years later, China awakened to a completely different reality. Being a closed society, it lost the significant advantage they had in the 15th century. Now, we have as topic the East-West corridor, which is about trade, which is about investment, which is about technology, in what is today Eurasia, as I said, a very important player in the global economy, the home and the house of 70%, among other things, of the energy reserves of the world. And we have seen in the morning how many hot points are along this arch, along this route. The question is it possible to have trade? Is it possible to have infrastructure? Is it possible to have investments in such a hot geopolitical climate? Now, this will be the topic which I'm going to try to address in our panel. And we will start by looking at the bigger picture. And the first speaker will be Mrs. Gao Chunyan. She will be followed by Francis Burwell. And then we are going to zoom into what is very much technology related. And Mr. Adrian Courage will speak about the Măgurele, the LI project, and he will be followed, the last speaker in the panel will be Mr. Paolo Correa, who is going to share with us some of the challenges, but some of the potential solutions in financing, developing infrastructure which helps trade and competitiveness. Because as I said, infrastructures are expensive, are long-term, and in addition to the commercial dimension, they carry always, be it roads, pipelines, whatever, they carry a very significant geopolitical dimension as well. Without further ado, I would like to invite Mrs. Gao Chunyan to give us her comments. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it is a great pleasure for me and my colleagues to be invited to participate in this forum. First of all, I wish to thank our Romanian hosts for their hard work to make this year's Bucharest Forum another success. Today, I would like to give a very brief introduction to the present situation of China's economy. And then I will touch a little bit upon China's economic cooperation with European countries, especially countries in the Central and Eastern Europe. To talk about China's economy, we have to mention the world economy first. Now, after 8 years of the international financial crisis, the recovery of global economy still falls far short of people's expectations. Global trade and investment are still lackluster. Commodities and financial markets have experienced volatility from time to time. Moreover, the destabilizing factors such as geopolitical conflicts, national populism, and terrorism are on the rise. Against such a backdrop, protectionism and inward-looking trends are on the rise. People began to question or even oppose globalization. However, the path of world economy development shows that the openness brings progress and isolation leads to backwardness. And in the age of economic globalization, countries are closely linked in their development, and they all rise and fall together. No country could seek development on its own. In order to promote world economic recovery and the growth of all economies, we need to make joint efforts to tackle challenges through coordination and cooperation. As the theme of the G20 Hangzhou Summit held 1 month ago puts it, we must work together towards an innovative, invigorated, interconnected, and inclusive world economy. Ladies and gentlemen, having experienced years of rapid growth, China's economy has entered a new normal. Although having witnessed a growth slowdown, China's economy still maintains a steady growth. In the first half of this year, China's economic growth rate remained at 6.7%, which is not easy for an economic entity whose aggregate reaches $10 trillion. The annual economic growth rate of China currently stands at 6 to 7%, which means $800 trillion of annual GDP growth volume. This is equivalent to the economic aggregate of a medium-sized economy. The reason why China must keep a medium to high growth rate is that China has a population of 1.3 billion, and the number of newly added workforce in cities and towns every year reaches 14 million. Moreover, there are still over 50 million impoverished people in China, and we have to use the power of the nation to declare a war on poverty. In order to maintain a medium to high economic growth rate, China is advancing economic restructuring and upgrade, and actively fostering new drivers and impetus while transforming and improving traditional production capacity. We have the confidence and ability to maintain medium-high rate of growth and deliver more development opportunities to the world while ensuring our own development. China's development has benefited from the international community, and we are ready to provide more public goods to the international community. The Belt and Road Initiative, put forward by China, is meant to achieve common prosperity, and major progresses have been made in launching key projects and building the economic corridors of the Silk Road Economic Belt. European countries are important partners for China. In recent years, China-EU relations has kept a sound and stable development with steady growth and upgrade of mutual trade and investment. Our two-way trade has reached to nearly $600 billion. This is about 200 times more than the level of $3 billion when the two sides established diplomatic relations 40 years ago. EU has been China's largest trading partner for 12 consecutive years, while China has been EU's second largest trading partner for 13 consecutive years. In light of the weak global economy and the sluggish world trade, both China and the EU have agreed that the two sides will work to synergize the Belt and Road Initiative with the Development Plan for Europe, the International Cooperation on Industrial Capacity with the Juncker Plan for Europe. We may say that China and the EU are moving from a buyer-seller relationship to a more comprehensive cooperation and are building a complementary and mutual beneficial partnership. Compared with the cooperation between China and the Western European countries, the economic and the trade cooperation between China and Central Eastern European countries had a later start. However, this cooperation has achieved tremendous progress in recent years and has become a highlight, a new growth point in China-EU economic cooperation. Since 2012, the 16+1 summit meetings had been held respectively in Warsaw, Bucharest, Belgrade, and Suzhou, with our cooperation getting increasingly enriched and mature. At present, China is partnering with other countries to advance the Belt and Road Initiative. As the 16 Central and Eastern European countries account for 1/4 of the countries along the routes, there is a lot we can do to further synergize our development strategies and to conduct cooperation on infrastructure development. As a matter of fact, the connectivity projects between China and Central and Eastern European countries are carrying forward at a high speed. For example, the China-Europe Rail Freight has conducted more than 1,260 trips. The Budapest Belgrade Railway Project, China-Europe Land-Sea Express Line, have achieved periodical progresses. Up to now, China has signed with 7 Central and Eastern European countries the Memorandum of Understanding on Cooperation on the Belt and Road Initiative. So the comprehensive and effective synergy of the Belt and Road Initiative with the 16+1 cooperation will undoubtedly help to promote regional cooperation to a new high, and it will surely have positive impact to the economic and social development of China and Central and Eastern European countries. Next month, the 5th summit meeting of heads of government of China and the 16 Central and Eastern European countries will be held in Riga, Latvia. And I'm sure it will open a new chapter for and will add new impetus to the 16+1 cooperation and the China-Europe cooperation. So the good opportunity of our cooperation is within reach. I hope both sides will seize this opportunity and work together to open up new prospects for win-win cooperation between China and Europe. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Next, Frances Burwell is going to share with us her insights into, again, the big picture of trade flows, risks, challenges, and opportunities coming from TPP or TTIP. The floor is yours, Frances. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The chairman, in starting out, put us the question of, is it possible to have trade and investment in an area that is undergoing, shall we say, some political and security strains and stresses? And I would argue that in the absence of overt conflict, which is not what we're talking about right now, that it is, in fact, not only possible, but indeed desirable to have investment and trade with these areas. And that particularly when one is talking about allies, one has to think about this very, very carefully. I would, in fact, take the lesson of the European Union, which was created in an economic basket case, actually, and used economic instruments to build a political union that, although it faces troubles today, has brought peace to Europe, to this area of Europe. I think the United States recognized this in Europe immediately after the Second World War, and in fact began the campaign that became known as the Marshall Plan, figuring that Europe would only be stable if we were able to invest and to push with our investments to achieve the political aim of a closer European Union. So I think that was no doubt motivated in part by business. Europe was our biggest market before the war, but also it was motivated by altruism and a desire to have a strong political partner across the Atlantic. So the question here for me is, after the election and the inauguration of a new US administration, how do we strengthen transatlantic economic ties and especially greater US engagement in Central Europe and the Black Sea region? I want to first look very briefly at the role that the US already plays in the European economy, and then ask why this is important very briefly. So my Chinese colleague has pointed out the very strong Chinese trade with Europe, but the leading trading partner of Europe is the United States, particularly when you add exports and imports together. US trade with Europe is about $700 billion in 2015. But I would also caution that trade is no longer the heartbeat of the transatlantic economy. Instead, that is really mutual investment. Currently, there are about 15 million jobs on both sides of the Atlantic that are paid for by companies from the other sides of the Atlantic. In other words, it's German car companies and others hiring workers in South Carolina in their factories, and the reversed scenario here in Europe. US investment in the EU currently totals about $1.8 trillion, while Chinese investment, which has only started very, very recently in the last couple of years, is, according to what I was able to find, $23 billion. US investment in Romania has been about $1.2 billion since the end of the Cold War. And the US is the strongest non-EU investor in Romania right now. Why is this important, that we have such a strong economic partnership? First, I think all of us know in our hearts that economics binds people together. Our alliance is stronger and closer because we have an economic stake in the success of each other. But also, a region needs external investment. It is true exactly what was said about closing economies off. Openness means prosperity. And a closed economy is quite the opposite. If you want another example, look at the autarkic economy of the Soviet Union, which was basically a basket case by the end of that political entity. But when you have external investment coming into your region, you also need to know what the impact will be on your region, what standards it will have to meet. And here, I think the EU has been very good in setting up certain standards that have to be met by all external investors. I'm not sure that some of my American friends who work at Google or Apple necessarily are keen on EU standards right now, but they are major players in the European marketplace, and they're subject to European rules. So what is now going to happen after the US election? The two things I want to talk about. One is TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, and the other is just the general area of investment. First, for TTIP, there is currently a round underway. I believe it will conclude either tonight or tomorrow in New York City. The negotiations, when you talk just simply about the trade negotiators themselves getting together, have been proceeding, in my view, in a way that is pretty standard for trade negotiators. They find lots of difficulties because that's what they're supposed to do. They are negotiators and they are supposed to find these things. They do not make public their successes very frequently. In fact, trade negotiations are generally done under what is known as a single undertaking, in which nothing is decided until it is all decided. And so when the German economics minister stands up and says, nothing has been decided, not a single chapter has been closed, that's kind of normal for trade negotiations and until the end. It's not like accession negotiations to the EU where people open a chapter and close a chapter. Trade negotiations inevitably need top political leadership to bring them to a close. That's just the reality. I've never seen one elsewhere. Trade negotiators will take the issues and they will find a few key issues that they cannot resolve, and those will go generally to the very top level. You saw the last big push, which was Chancellor Merkel and President Obama at the Hanover Trade Fair in the spring. And we've since seen President Obama make a few statements about how he hopes that TTIP will be resolved before he leaves office. I have to say that I'm now increasingly skeptical that's going to happen, but I actually don't think that that's of huge consequence. If I were sitting in the European seat, I would probably be asking myself, quite frankly, whether I wanted to finish negotiations with this president or wait until the next president. We need now to look forward, because I think we really are talking about a political year that will start, that has already started for us a long time ago in the United States, but that includes the American election, the American inauguration, and the first beginnings of our government, and then as well the French and German elections in 2017. So my expectation, I mean, first off, you have all heard the trade discussion going on about within the context of the US election. It has been rather bruising, with a lot of criticism of trade in general. And I think one of the things the next US president is going to have to do is to make the case for a more open economy, because that criticism has come from both the left and the right. However, I would say that most of the criticism has been leveled at NAFTA, an agreement which has been around for quite some years, and also at the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Rarely do we hear the Trans-Atlantic Trade and Investment Partnership mentioned at all. When you do, it is only in the sense, and I'm not even sure that she knows she's referring to it, where Secretary Clinton will say something along the lines of, I will never sign a trade agreement that doesn't have high wage and environmental standards. Well, negotiating with Europe is quite different, very different from negotiating with the TPP partners or with many others that we have negotiated with. This is a high wage, high standard economy. It is also a big economy, and that is one of the difficulties with TTIP, is that you now have the two elephants in the room. Both the US and the European Union are used to negotiating with Chile, Peru, maybe a Korea, maybe South Korea, but not with someone who is their equivalent at the negotiating table, and that is very, very tough. So I do think, though, that the agreement, the idea of the agreement, makes absolute sense. It will bring about a half percentage point in GDP to each of our economies. In particular, we don't know the positive ramifications for the services economies, which is a growing part of our economy, and the digital economy, which is also a growing part of our transatlantic economy. And we have no way, really, of estimating what it will do in terms of cross-Atlantic mutual investment, because those are decisions made individually by companies. But a forecast that we did on the benefits to US states showed that every state in the United States gained via TTIP. And in fact, it showed that every congressional district gained by TTIP in some way, sometimes very modestly and sometimes quite a lot. So when the new president takes office, it will take a few months to get the trade people in place and to start things. And I think we also will see a phenomenon that we've seen before, which I call review, rename, and relaunch. I would not be surprised to see a renamed trade agreement. Either presidential candidate will have to have a review of trade policy. And inevitably, presidents have some area that they want to revisit in order to claim the agreement as their own. We have all seen this in all of our governments. It's perfectly normal. But I do think that the trade talks will be relaunched by, say, summer 2017, and that by sometime in 2018, we will have an agreement that we hope will go through the European Parliament before it ends its term in June 2019. So that would be my ambition and my scenario for TTIP. I'm very happy in the Q&A to talk about some of the issues that TTIP faces, particularly here in Europe, and to some degree in the United States in terms of popular opposition. Finally, let me just say a few words on investment. The US doesn't have a government policy about investing in other areas of the world. And in other words, we don't go out and we like to encourage investment, but in the end, it is the choice of our companies to invest. And so what we can do is, I would say basically two things. One is encourage governments like those in Romania to provide the right conditions that will encourage companies to make a choice, a positive choice, for this region and this country. And what I hear from companies, American companies, is not necessarily cheap workers or a cost measure, but it is predictability and the rule of law. And so I want to just say that the current direction in which Romania is going is being extremely well received in Washington. And so we look forward to much more stability in that area. Finally, one other strategy is to do what we can politically to strengthen the economies in the region. Whatever it is in terms of pipelines, reducing economic dependencies that might be factors that could weaken the economy, encouraging regional integration. And we at the Atlantic Council have become done work advocating that infrastructure networks be built on a more north-south direction as well as the traditional east-west in this region, linking the economies from Estonia to Croatia with networks in transport, energy, and telecoms. And we think that might be something that politically a US government might be able to get behind when it seeks to engage here and use that as a framework for encouraging private firms to make the decisions they need to make to invest in this region. Thank you.
When we talk about Europe, everyone talks about a number of crises converging on Europe. Migrants, Brexit, you name it, which combined can generate what is called a perfect storm, which can wreck the European ship. Another crisis which Europe is facing, but which goes much more silent, is the competitiveness one, which is largely ignored. It doesn't make headlines. And in the competitiveness area, Europe is falling behind significantly in what is called the digital economy. There is a growing gap with the US and with Asia. And this is worrying to the point that European Commission designed a digital strategy. All good on paper. Let's see it in action. Adrian Curaj is going to present a Romanian project which has unique characteristics in terms of competitiveness, in terms of cooperation, in terms of very broad impact. And he's going to use some slides, again, in order to re-energize us all. Thank you, Adrian.
Thank you, and good afternoon. Yeah, I prepared some slides because I know it's difficult after lunch break to have a presentation. I put some colors in, you will see. So, and also I try to use the colors and slides to challenge you a little bit. How many times we have a chance to write a story? Many times we use stories, storytelling, when we talk about impact, when we use them in benchmarking, in different evaluation. I am coming from science and innovation, so I use my area to give examples. But you know, not so many times we are in the position to write the story. And I think, and my intention is to go with you in details of how we write the story of orchestrating territorial innovation ecosystem. And from the very high macro level, the first two presentations, I will jump to the meso level. And it is about the way you use uniqueness in science and technology. You put different ingredients related to regional development and European funds. You talk about smart specialization not as a buzzword, being with the feet on the ground. And everything is about the concept we have, Laser Valley Land of Lights. But each concept has to have something behind, and is there somebody helping me? Because I think I don't have battery in my... Next slide, please. Okay, fine. I will say next slide because I don't have battery in this one. What's about? And I'll make the long story short, but giving you the core of the meaning of what is happening. Extreme light infrastructure, it is an European project, pan-European project, started in 2006. And it is about a revolution in laser science, the most powerful laser in the world. And in 2006, Europe decided to put resources and decided to have a project, subject being put on the European strategic list of infrastructure, research infrastructure. And also Europe put some money in 2007-09 in a project preparing the overall concept. And guess what? From the nice, beautiful expectation in 2006, actually we decided at European level, we decided the first idea was not at all credible from the technological point of view. And instead of having one project, we decided at European level to have three pillars approaching in different and three different ways the subject of laser of very high powers. So from one site, one laser, we decided to have a distributed infrastructure, and Romania, Czech Republic and Hungary is hosting each of the countries one pillar. By chance, Romania hosts the pillar of lasers and nuclear physics, and it is not coming from, I don't know, out of the blue. It's coming from the recent scientific and technological experience of Romania in nuclear physics, and also the recent history in lasers. In Romania was built the first laser in the world. So taking advantage of the existing capabilities, Romania at the European level and Romania fighting for this, was decided Romania to host this infrastructure. Sorry. Yeah, I have this again. Nice colors. In Czech Republic, it's about Beamlife facility. In Hungary, about Ato Second facility, and in Romania, about nuclear physics. But you know, I liked very much in 2008 when we finally decided what's about this distributed research infrastructure. The overall message was, because of the uniqueness of science and technology, go east, young man, because it is something special for you. And the message was not prepared by Romanians, was prepared by Gerard Mourou, the father of the technology for these lasers. We work a lot with him, and we are still working together. And it was the idea of brain drain. And this time it's about, at least about brain circulation, because the uniqueness of technology of science could attract and be an engine for science and innovation. What is actually the next step? One important one, the key one, because it was something disruptive, it was in 2010, when starting for the nuclear physics and the uniqueness of the laser, 100 scientists and people working in technology came from all around the world, and we all decided we need something extra. And we put a second light in the game. Laser is about light, a second light, gamma beam. So it is possible to have an amazing space of different experiments, and the white paper of experiments does not mean only experiments in scientific area, but also all the connections with technologies, different technologies. I will give you an example. Nuclear transmutation, it's a business worldwide of around 100 billion euros worldwide. Romania will play, will have a say here in this direction. And many, many different other things. And also in 2015, we managed to redesign the technical design report, the white paper, going more in details, understanding you may have a nice, beautiful, amazing, beautiful scientific infrastructure. If you don't see real the connection with technology and you don't build the links for the business and for the economic environment, I think you have nothing, you don't have a full-fledged environment. And today you are talking about unlocking the economic potential, and that's why we put a lot of effort in unlocking the potential of the infrastructure for development. It's okay, the building is there. We already started installing the equipments, and in 2017, 18, 19, and so on, we'll have it installed and up and running. Some complementary actions, because what I said until now is about science, technology, but we have already had complementary actions in the idea of orchestrating the territorial innovation ecosystem development. In 2011, before even project to start, we had a study from KPMG about innovation and the potential of streamlined infrastructure in this game. It was a very, very early stage message about the role and opportunity. Immediately, the Foreign Investors Council in Romania put the streamlined infrastructure in the top five investments in Romania, talking about impact for the business and new jobs, high-level jobs. And it was a quite silence period between 2011 and 2015, because almost everybody was focused on building, having the project running, financed, and so on. But in 2015, we had a very nice vision building exercise, and we put a lot of stakeholders together. And actually, it was the time moving the dialogue from the core research infrastructure, streamlined infrastructure, to a broader development concept. And we end up with laser valley land of lights. I would prefer to say land of lights. Lights, because laser, it's about lights. Gamma beam is about lights. That's why we have lights at the plural. Yeah? And the laser valley, because it is a concept, development concept, is not just about and only about science. And the next slides are really colorful, and you will see what we put and what are the axes we cover with this vision document. Principles from how to live in the area, how to be, to what is about education, the innovation infrastructure in the area, business, science in the area, so an overall development concept. And of course, we work with diagrams, trying to understand the territory, and we focus our efforts in being a vision document to highlight the main action lines we need. Of course, one of the key area and key subject is how to be better connected, how sort of smart infrastructure you need, how you facilitate the business in the area, because science is there. And the next slides are just part of the nice, beautiful colored. And later on in March this year, 2016, we decided, hey guys, if we talk about a vision and we prepare a vision, it is not quite a self-fulfilling prophecy one, but anyhow, it's a vision, highlighting the main direction of development. We want to be more precise about the land, about the territory, and we work with the University of Architecture for an international competition of ideas, young architects, urban developers, and we already receive the projects. They were evaluated, and we now also have the winners. 28 ideas, amazing, interesting, a lot of information. Why? Because putting all these pieces together, it is about informing policymakers in what we hope in smart decision related orchestrating the development of innovation ecosystem for a large territory. I put here the three first prize, second, and the third prize for the competition. And just today, we receive an extra significant piece of this jigsaw. It's the impact, the socioeconomic impact assessment study done by Price Waterhouse. It was an amazing work because they work 1 month for only one month for such a study. It's incredible, and we receive it, and it is part of what we need for going in the next steps. And also, we start talking with the World Bank because on a medium and long-term run, we need a sort of support for spillover, full-fledged context and spillovers around what we are doing. And of course, after all this impact assessment study and discussion with World Bank in preparing the technical assistance, there are some key challenges I want to point out, and I am almost at the end of my presentation. First, if it is to talk about development, definitely you need a sort of governance, business governance model, how to govern the development, because it is not just building a research infrastructure, we have it. It's just about making the context and the territory fit for doing high-tech business and for contributing to the sense of funds European Commission decided to put in this research infrastructure. Funds for cohesion, from structural funds. If it is about cohesion, everybody is expecting new jobs, high-tech jobs, business around, not only science. Science we have, and it is really beautiful. But also a part of governance model, infrastructure. And it is not only connectivity. It's about smart infrastructure development. If we talk about large territory, what kind of infrastructure we need before starting building, so many blocks and to have private investment in. And definitely at the end of this year we will have also an integrated territorial development plan. That means, what means this? Of course we look at the territory with different ideas from the competition of architects, but also we have to take it into account the area is part of the Bucharest metropolitan area. So we have to link in a way what is happening in Bucharest and Bucharest development with what is happening around. So we need this just because of a type of predictability you have to give to the expected investors, just to understand what you are doing and what are steps and how they could do business and contribute to the development. Of course, we are very much interested in international marketing, and soon I hope to have a consolidated package with impact assessment study, with the result of the competition of architecture and so on, just to present from, I consider, enough early stage to the different possible investors what's happened in the area, giving a sense of predictability of what we are doing there. Of course, we are also talking about a new project because ALI is running well. It is actually in the next phase in installing equipment, but definitely the challenge is data we will have from experiments. Definitely everybody will say no way to use the same models in understanding the data from experiments. So we work already start working with IBM for a cognitive computing facility in the area, and it is linked also with core competencies in ICT of Romania. But different other plugins for the ALI-NP project for being used by the business in different industrial application. So it's orchestrating the development of an integrated innovation ecosystem. And of course, working more active with stakeholders, not only for presenting the ideas, but also to have them on board for smart decision and to have their contribution, even they are from public or private, for the next steps. Everything, again, is about orchestrating. You may have a lot of nice, beautiful players. If you don't have a nice conductor, I think maybe the concert will be the most, will be at the highest possible level. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Adrian. I think your presentation and the project tells us that it is not all doom and gloom in Europe. And this is a project which has some special characteristics. First of all is cutting-edge innovation. And in this respect, to use the laser language, this is a ray of hope. Yeah? So it's cutting-edge with industrial, significant potential industrial and not only application, which in addition will generate local and regional development and social regeneration in many ways. So there are many benefits coming. And I think the second lesson which I drew from your presentation is that sometimes strategists, military planners, with all due respect, think in the old paradigm, the conventional, the classical paradigm, which is 19th century, early 20th century. One should not, must not ignore the impact which the technological advances, developments can bring on the geostrategic or strategic thinking and paradigm. And in this respect, I think we should encourage technology to sit at all the strategic conversations. Thank you again. Now, the last speaker in our panel is Paolo Correa, and we are very eager to learn from his experience in Eurasia, what is called Europe and Central Asia region, as well as from his fabulous experience in the largest economy in Latin America. So the floor is yours, Paolo, thank you.
Thank you very much, Chair. I wanted to thank the Aspen Institute of Romania, the German Marshall Fund also for inviting us to be present in this important conference. And for us, it's really a very interesting opportunity. I'd like to start going back to the first two panelists and highlighting the fact that compared to 6 or 10 years ago, the global environment for growth is not exactly the same. To put it mildly, we have been better environments, better global environments for growth. So there are issues related to trade, there are issues related to the role of China, there are several issues that trade continues to be a very important engine of growth, but rather countries are being provoked or pushed to find internal sources of growth. And when we think of internal sources, of internal engines of growth, a natural candidate is innovation, is technology absorption, is investment in research, especially in Europe, that since Lisbon agenda and its targets on R&D has put innovation at the core of its development strategy. Now, this is not new, and Romania, as part of the European Union, has been trying to do that for a while. What I wanted to briefly discuss with you is how this early opportunity is de facto, potentially, and I wanted to underline the potential game changer for Romania. And to make this potential happen will depend essentially on policy choices, on investment choices that were just highlighted here before. And I wanted to emphasize this because we do believe, as the World Bank, this is a potentially a game changer for the economy. We have been talking, I had the chance to work in Romania for a few years, and at least since 10 years ago, the idea of having Romania growth based much more on a knowledge economy, on, I don't like the word high tech, but on knowledge-based sectors as the way to run away from the middle-income trap. You know, the fact that middle-income countries are having difficulties to continue to growth is not new. This idea has been around for 10 years. Now, I think the country has a real opportunity to get this going. So let me let me explore a little bit why this is the case and what are the conditions for making it happen. To a large extent, this builds on what Mr. Kuraj has just presented before. So essentially, what is ELI, this extreme light infrastructure project? In my view as an economist, I'm not an engineer, I'm not a scientist, but from my point of view, there are 3 or 4 issues that are very important and makes it a novelty from what we had before here. The first, this is a pan-European project. Second, this is a world-class infrastructure research facility. That implies that it will attract top-notch scientists from all the world involved in this field to here, Romania, and will generate important new research results, research outputs here in Romania. Now, why have been all these is we can take for granted that will happen because the investment and the research facility is being built. Now, for the hope, as was mentioned, for the opportunity and for the potential to be realized, what needs to be done? We will call this very briefly that what I'm going to argue is what are the enabling conditions for this to happen? What Adrian called, how can we create an environment in which these spillovers will happen? So first, what are these spillovers? I mean, how this all investment in science can generate economic development? Let's think very briefly in 3 ways. One, new science can generate more science. So one way is, we have a situation in which foreign scientists come here, do their experiment, and go back to their own country. This is one situation. Another situation is because the academic environment is such that they come, they do their experiment, but they hire local researchers. They establish long-term joint cooperation with these researchers. They decide to stay longer to do new research that is related to the new findings. So these are spillovers in science. This is one benefit that may stay here if the academic and scientific environment is conducive for those top researchers to choose to stay longer because they have these better conditions here, or competitive new different conditions, but to do this additional research. So this is one type of spillover. The second spillover is more on the economic side, and it has to do with the nature of this facility. This is not a standard lab, as you guys can imagine. This is a completely different, and the term unique has been used. I wanted to use it as well. And its uniqueness will generate the need to implement and the demand for several services. And I'm not talking about restaurants or hotel services, that will be there. I'm talking about maintenance services, preparation of experiments, and a number of knowledge-intensive services that can be provided by the private sector. Now, it can be provided by the private sector from abroad, or it can be provided by the private sector that decides to locate here. Location is partially derived also by the type of services that sometimes proximity is needed. But again, if we have this enabling environment that will encourage firms to locate in the proximity of the where the facility is located, which is the Maghreb region, these firms will come, and the local economy will be dynamized. It will generate some dynamics for the local economy based on the provision of knowledge-intensive services. Again, these services can be provided. It's not matter who owns the firm, multinationals, startups. The point is, if the provision of the service is local, this will generate a completely different dynamic for the local economy and in a second level effect to the Romanian economy as well. A third, we can think about the traditional innovation spillovers. This is very basic research being done there. However, as we know by experience, basic research at some point does derive new ideas for applied research, in which from there you can get new ideas for the development of products and services. And we all have the fantasy with the Silicon Valley or the, for example, the NIH corridor in the I-270 in Washington, where you have a lot of startups in the biotech sector. And we could go on and on in France and in Europe. Well, the idea of the valley here is exactly this potential, is to replicate, and it sounds a bit science fiction or romanticism, but there is really this potential. Again, the challenge, once the infrastructure investment is happening, is to do all the set of reforms in the innovation system that we need locally to make these spillovers happen. So you do need entrepreneurship, you do need risk capital, you do need encouragement for scientists to look at more carefully business opportunities and engage with the private sector to do contract research, to collaborate with the private sector, and why not, to become entrepreneurs, as we have seen in some cases. Scientists are scientists, but under the appropriate environment, they can at least engage in the development of new business. And this is so much so with the young generation. So we're talking about that facilitating the occurrence of these spillovers will help not only change the pattern of growth in Romania to a more knowledge-intensive pattern, but also the creation of jobs and better salaries for the youth. So I think this idea, again, and I just saw the slide saying youngsters go east. In the case of the youngsters here, you just stay. You can, brain drain is not bad. The issue is not brain drain or brain gain. The issue is brain circulation, and you want to be part of the circulation process. You it's good that youth go abroad, but you want them to come back and go abroad and come back. But brain circulation, and you have the potential to do that now. So I talked about the potential for a bit longer because I wanted you to have a sense of the opportunity that is in place right now. And I just wanted to highlight a bit more what are the conditions for this to happen. On the innovation side, I already briefly made reference to the ecosystem that you need to advance. And this is easier said than done. Mr. Kuraj himself has been working with this for several years. The bank has been engaged in trying to help some reforms here and in other countries in the region. This is very difficult. But perhaps you now have an opportunity to do that, exactly triggered by the potential impact of this. It would be too long to pinpoint each of these reforms, but I think this is one area to be taken into account. It has to do with investing in new programs to support angel investors or those poor venture capital, but also changing the incentive regime, how we do science, a lot of emphasis on the microeconomics of technology transfer to get incentives right, so on and so forth. The other set of conditionalities, I think, would be exactly related to the second type of spillover. You want the firms to locate here to provide the services to this new gigantic infrastructure. So for that, you need a good climate for doing business. You need an attractive environment for FDI. You also want to provide, why not, firm capabilities and firm support policies for small firms that could also be created locally given the engineering and the scientific capacity. Some engineers, local engineers, some scientists may find a business opportunity in the provision of knowledge-intensive services for this new infrastructure. So take into consideration this type of environment would be very important too. And finally, what is the most obvious one is related to the infrastructure and the amenities. I mean, you don't want a top researcher to come here and run away back home. You want him to be happy in where he's staying. You want him to enjoy. You want him to want to bring the family. If this is going to be a campus-like investment out of the blue, a new one, or if this is going to be renovation of some areas with historical potential and a lake, only cost-benefit analysis could tell what is more effective. But this type of investment, as much as, of course, on connectivity, which has to do with transportation, but also with telecommunication services, so because the amount of data being generated, as was also mentioned before, is going to be completely unimaginable right now, are other things to be taken into account. So I think all this seems a bit challenging, but I do believe that if we start thinking about these things right now, there is enough time to have these conditions in place. I think this what I try to highlight here is this investment, this early investment, not only as a fantastic scientific and economic opportunity, but also potentially a fantastic opportunity to do some reforms that in the past could not be done, because now the benefits of these reforms could be even more obvious given the existence of this technology. I would like to finalize saying that that from the bank side, as you probably guessed by now, we are very excited with this opportunity, with the opportunity to collaborate with Romania again in such an important topic, and we are right now looking for forms to make this collaboration viable. So that's it. Thank you very much.
The only one actor, and I'm looking at you, Francis, though you're an American on the panel, that does something in this respect was European Union under the Juncker plan, which doesn't specifically look at that logic. It does have export and growing European exports and trade as one of its criteria, but it's not geared towards that. while One Belt, One Road, in a sense, it's a development instrument, but it's certainly also a trade policy instrument. How do you go about financing the Western element of it and creating coherent policy space for it?
Romania is graduating from that kind of thing. I mean, you know, that was, there was seed funding, we used to call it, after 1989. But in, to be frank, Romania is now seen as not a incredibly risky economy, so it's one where the private corporations have to make their own decisions. This is sometimes a disadvantage in terms of, shall we say, public diplomacy, but I think it does make the recipient countries work hard to get what is needed for a sustainable economy and for sustainable investment practices. The Juncker investment plan is very interesting because other countries can buy into it, and as well as private capital firms and things like that. So it's 315 billion, but that's not what the EU as an institution is contributing, obviously. Even though it is geared primarily towards creating jobs and growth within Europe as opposed to foreign trade and investment, I don't think those are incompatible. In fact, I think they're mutually reinforcing. So whether it is, for example, transport infrastructure, things of that area, of that nature, telecoms infrastructure, port infrastructure, things like that, all of those things can affect investments by non-European companies to invest and to sell goods. So I think those are all good things and they're related.
My name is Adela Ude, I'm a lawyer. I'd like to ask a question to Mrs. Frances Burwell as well. In our view, which were the most sensitive issues during the negotiation for the TTIP?
We have a system in the United States, and it goes from the federal government all the way down to cities sometimes, because first off, the federal government sets its own rules for what it buys, and then the states set their own rules, and then counties and every level of government can set its own rules. And many of them have what we call Buy America. It sounds great, and that's unfortunate because... it sounds great, Buy America, it sounds very patriotic, but what it means is that European companies have a harder challenge to sell to U.S. government agencies, everything from paper clips to earth-moving equipment to whatever. So that is going to be one of the things that we have to deal with in TTIP. And I suspect that, because I see TTIP as more of a living platform, there'll be future negotiations, that we will get somewhere on the federal level, but there's an internal constitutional issue for us about whether the federal level can make the other levels of government agree to something on that at this point. For the Europeans, I think it's pretty clear which are the most sensitive issues. Investor protection disciplines, and I think we will have to do something along the lines of CETA, where there is a more transparent process than what has been in the past. But there are a whole lot of reasons for that and things we could go into. I would just remind everyone that actually investor protection is a German invention, so I think that's one of the issues. The other one is something that has to do with what people describe as standards. So there's this idea out there that we will create through TTIP gold-plated standards, and we will, and somehow this has become that the US and Europe negotiators will force us to all have the same standards in air pollution or the quality of children's clothing in terms of flame retardant or over-the-counter drugs or whatever. In reality, what's being discussed by the negotiators is really bureaucratic stuff like, can you set up testing regimes for over-the-counter drugs that are actually similar and require the companies to submit the same data? Not, do they have the same standards? So there is no nothing in TTIP that's being discussed that removes the sovereign right of the EU to set standards or of the United States to set standards. It's more about how do we make it easier so that companies can actually not duplicate what they're doing or not go through two sets of testing when one set would do very well. Just to give an example, in the I forget which way it goes, but in one of us, we test crash test cars with a dummy with a seatbelt on, and the other one, the dummy does not get to wear a seatbelt. And this has led to different bumpers. So let's find out if we can actually crash test the dummies one way.
One final question from Mircea Joana.
You know, if you look at the map, geography of the planet, by and large, remains the same. As Vasile Iuga so eloquently presented the Silk Road, irrespective of the era, when the geopolitical and geoeconomic conditions are met, this route, which is a natural one, comes back to life. When it looks to our part of Europe, it's interesting to see that both for European Union, which has established in 1996-95 the pan-European transport corridor system, the 10 pan-European corridor systems. And if somebody has the curiosity, and I do encourage the ones who are not paying daily attention or attention to this, to look to corridor number 9, which in European pan corridor number 9, which connects Greece to Bulgaria, to Romania, that is goes to Chisinau and then to Kiev, then will be to Odessa, then to St. Petersburg, then to Moscow, and then to Finland. If you look to the One Belt, One Road, the Chinese president of China's, I think, number one global geoeconomic initiative, if I understood correctly, you see that basically the Chinese version of the Silk Road is basically identical, with some exceptions, to the European corridor. Now, the problem with Europe and the problem with countries like Romania is that we procrastinate. So it takes something like 20 years to start working on something which makes sense. And what Francis was saying about North-South, and when we speak about Romania gateway, everybody wants to be a gateway someplace. South Africa, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, everybody wants to be a gateway. That's competition. So my question, basically, to I think to Vasile Iuga, you can dare challenge the moderator, and to our Chinese colleague, it's clear there is a, some form of competition, 16 plus 1. Not everybody in Brussels is happy that the Chinese are, you know, engaging some, including Romania, and I believe it's a very good idea. So the question is, when it comes to financing this North-South corridor, and can we really find a middle of the road where if there is Chinese or other investment to do a portion of the railroad, is the longest European corridor of transport, it's 6,000 kilometers of rail and 500 kilometers of road, this North-South thing, which makes sense. So my question is, are we also competing for financing this? I'm asking our American friends because that's clear that when we started the Bucharest Forum 5 years ago, it was the new Silk Road, that was the name. Also because Hillary Clinton, Secretary of State at that time, she said something about new Silk Road, but it was mainly Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, it was not this road. So the question is, if there is, on the European side, either a lack of interest or on Romanian side, the lack of implementation capacity, how do you go about this? And one very short final question to both Minister Courage and Paolo. And also I want to thank the exceptional team at PwC that have produced this pre-feasibility study, which is also indicating that we have a chance. If you'll be putting this in terms of phasing an investment like Laser Valley, if we do things right, let's think for 1 second, then Romania's governance will improve magically. It's not impossible, by the way, I'm not ironical. Let's think that the public and private sectors will work correctly. Let's hope that the expertise of the bank of the World Bank and the private sector will be there, that IBM will be putting cognitive, I mean, let's say in the ideal scenario, how long does it take between the inception, which is already there, the physical infrastructure for physics is about to be completed next year, but in a realistic way, reaching almost the full potential of this such an investment, in your experience with other projects, similar projects around the world, how long would it take? And if you can have a sort of a gross estimation of input output in terms of investment versus return in the economic and let's say horizontal impact on the economy.
Mircea, I will start myself. We agreed with Mrs. Chunyan that I will try to answer your very provocative question because it's very much related to Romania, in a way. And I will start from the same point where you started. 10 years ago, European Union, or 20 years ago, European Union said, these are the 10 transport corridors. Romania was supposed to be included in 3 of them, basically. Number 4, which is Arad, Brasov, București, Constanța, both road and rail. Number 7, which is the Danube. And number 9, which was supposed to be north-south, crossing our region of Moldova. I think that the Romanian governments failed in defending Corridor 9. And Corridor number 9 was very important because it was supposed to irrigate the Romanian Moldova, the Romanian region of Moldova, which needs investment. And in this respect, infrastructure is critical. And as a result, Corridor number 9 was abandoned, and we have seen conversations about north-south corridors emerging a few years ago, but this time not crossing Romania, but being situated rather west of Romania. It's about Poland to Croatia, with maybe a small appendix into Romania. Now, I think that in this respect, the portion of the One Belt, One Road, which is supposed to replace Corridor number 9, is very important for Romania, because you need infrastructure which is not next or very close to the border, but which goes through the main regions of the country in order to irrigate what I would call the economic tissues, the economic body. And I think Romania should push and press for finding finance, or for this to be included in a form of financing which is supported by the European Union, in order to benefit from a real north-south corridor which will cross Romania as well. As far as the financing is concerned, probably Paolo is much more qualified than me to answer this, because it was my intention also to ask him, based on his experience, how he sees the financing of the infrastructure related to the Silk Road overall. Because if we look, for instance, at the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank funding, my understanding is that funding available will be 200 billion euros or dollars, whatever, whereas the needs for investment in Asian infrastructure are of 800 billion euros a year anyway. So the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank cannot cover everything. Therefore, the likes of EIB, the EBRD, the Americans, should come with smart financing, if we're talking about smart approach to things, in order to finance the development of the Silk Road. But on the financing mechanism, I think Paolo is much more qualified than me.
So to put it bluntly, I really don't know, but a couple of ideas here. You know. So first, about the bank. We have a very tight mandate in terms of focusing on poverty reduction. So there are good ideas for development. If they don't have this target, I mean, sometimes it's hard for us to get involved. But more importantly, we are currently in a situation in which for the we are reaching the ceiling of our capacity to lend because of the amount of capital that we have. So it's not the most comfortable moment to be engaging in large lending operations like this one would require. But my experience from Brazil, and I was about to say that, I was involved in, part of my mandate was exactly to look for private financing for infrastructure investment. And I was really surprised by the availability of private long-term resources. You know, starting from European funds, you know, pension funds, institutional investors, you know, insurance companies, even sovereign funds, essentially investors that have their liabilities compatible with the long-term return that infrastructure investment would provide. By the way, long-term and, if designed properly, long-term and low risk as well. Huh? So my at least the lesson for most of Latin American countries, and Brazil certainly, is that what we lack, frankly, is not it's not resources. Of course, there are some infrastructure projects. They are not payable by the private sector. They're not bankable, huh? Because you don't have enough demand to pay for it. Then is another story, right? You want to develop a poor region and put a big dam or put a big infrastructure piece there, you have to finance from the public sector. Now, a lot of the private, a lot of the infrastructure needed is private finance. What you need is a good project. Number one, good projects that are bankable and that investors could recognize a sort of risk allocation that is treatable for them. This is number one. And I think the second thing is, I think it was mentioned here, is predictability and stability in the rules of the game. Because the last thing these guys want, again, since these investments are 30-year long to provide the return, 40-year long to provide the return, you don't want to be investing in places where the rules of the game change all the time, because this is equivalent to quasi-expropriation. You calculate one return when you see you have 10% less, 20% less, and then you have your fiduciary obligations with your investors. So predictability and good projects would do a very good, it would be very good for mobilizing private resources.
Thank you. Thank you, Paulo. And Adrian, your comments?
Just a short comment. You know, I don't know how long it takes to have the full-fledged environment, but anyhow, it's important to have to see as waves of development. You will see it's not necessary to have everything from the beginning. It's hard to have a scenario covering everything. It's moving because technology is moving, science is moving, and it is obvious, clear, if you look at the global infrastructure, research infrastructure. They start maybe 20 years ago, 30 years ago, and they continue to grow up, and new ideas, new developments. Again, it's important to send a message of sense-making and predictability of what we are doing. And also the initiatives in the core area of science and innovation to be well associated with initiatives in setting up the ingredients for the ecosystem to be proactive, pro-development. So let's see. Anyhow, it's obvious, clear, the time frame you have for taking the full advantage of the uniqueness is not so large. So let's do it, move it as fast as possible, and let things happening in a coherent way. That's why it's about orchestrating what is happening.
A few final words from Mrs. Chunyan.
Thank you. When China puts forward the initiative of One Belt, One Road, we are not intended to start new wells. Rather, our aim of this initiative is to complement and improve the current international economic cooperation mechanisms. So China's open drive is not one man's play. It is an invitation to all countries, is meant for the common prosperity and the common development of the whole world. When we're talking about the financing of the infrastructure construction, we also set up about, let me say, 10 billions of loan for within the 16 plus one cooperation. Of course, we understand that there is a very strict standard from the European side on the for the member states in terms of government debt. So we are willing for flexible ways to finance this infrastructure construction. Thank you.
And with this, thank you for your attention and your patience. And I suggest we give a round of applause to our panelists. Thank you.